Okay, so let me now actually tackle this issue as, you know, will North Korea give up the bomb? And, you know, my answer is not anytime soon, certainly not voluntarily. And so we must make it more attractive, you know, for them to give up the bomb and then more costly to keep the bomb. My own view with looking at the North Korean situation is China holds the key to make it more costly for them. Because China still today is the major lifeline for North Korea. That's where most of the trade is. Not so much aid, but huge amount of trade. And so if China makes them pay by cutting off the contacts, that will make the North Koreans rethink. But the Chinese have a very different view of all of this. They don't want North Korea to have the bomb, but they don't want to bring North Korea to its knees to give up the bomb. The US and the Republic of Korea, South Korea, hold the key to the benefits. But the thing that's most important, you have to understand, why did they want the bomb in the first place? To understand as to why they would give it up. And the reasons, in the spirit of Professor Sagan's three models for the bomb, namely security, domestic reasons, and international statement, or international reasons, is, you know, that they feel is their best guarantee for survival. It's a deterrent. And when I've talked to the North Koreans, that's what they call it. Their deterrent. The deterrent means they're going to keep us out of their country. The domestic and the international reasons, during the first, you know, almost 40 years of the program, at least 35 or so, were not a part of the equation because they didn't admit to their people or internationally that they actually had a nuclear weapons program. But once they tested, then they went both directions. From domestic reasons, you know, they actually said, we have to have this bomb because that's what's going to keep the Americans out. And to some extent, again, looking at the Soviet analogy, you know, just having to say that we need the bomb, we have these tensions. Increasing the tensions sort of distracts these poor people's attention from the daily grievances that they have of living in a society like that. So the external threat justifies the bomb justifies the sacrifices, so it has domestic reasons. So today, the young leader, Kim Jong-un, has actually written having nuclear weapons into their constitution. So they are now a nuclear weapons state. International statement, for the most part, they've used it as sort of their ace, their playing card. So they're able to get concession, they're able to get and try to bring the rest of the world to a bargaining chip. So security was and remains the most important, but the other two have followed. So how do you know anything about North Korea? Well, lo and behold, they've invited people like me in. And particularly in my case, it was Professor John Lewis had established what we call a track two relationship with the North Koreans. And track two is for when the governments aren't talking, somebody has to talk and explore ideas, and that's what he was doing. And he invited me to go along for my first visit a little over 10 years ago in 2004. And that's the visit where they had actually wanted somebody like me with technical credentials, you know, being from Los Alamos, to actually tell the world that, hey, they have the bomb, because the Bush administration wasn't listening to them in 2003. And so they wanted to send that message. They went as far as actually allowing me to hold their plutonium in my hand, in a marmalade jar, nevertheless, you know, with a nicely tight screwed-on lid. And then later, this picture is from 2007, when I was there actually in their plutonium laboratory. Again, they wanted to show me this high-tech capability that they had of dealing with these materials. So that's how you know what's there. And I've had occasion to be there seven times. And for those seven visits, we've been able to put together a pretty good picture of what we think North Korea has, except we're lacking on the centrifuge end and the uranium enrichment. This is a whole series of satellite imagery of this light water reactor that they're building. I was there last in November 2010 when it was just coming out of the ground. And today what we can see is the exterior is complete. You know, I would guess within the next year or so, this light water reactor, which is their experimental reactor to make electricity with a modern type reactor. The ones that they had built were good for making plutonium and not so good for making, I'm sorry, for making plutonium, not so good for making electricity. So we watch them. You know, it's the most watched place in the entire world, constantly doing satellite imagery, and there's certain things you can see, but certain things you can't. So in order to really bring home what North Korea has today, I've taken this 10-year look back, and essentially close to when I first went there, but I go back to January 2003. That's right when, after the confrontation between Bush administration and Kim Jong-il's regime, they walked away from the Non-Proliferation Treaty, kicked out the international and American technical team, and this is, in essence, what they had. What they had was plutonium, very, very little. Maybe enough for a bomb, likely not. Highly enriched uranium, I'm reasonably confident that they had none. Nuclear tests, we know they had none. Nuclear weapons, probably also none. Long-range rocket, they only tried one and it failed. So in 2003, they had very, very little. So the Clinton administration agreed framework has been criticized heavily because it was felt that it wasn't doing enough to get those guys just to stop everything. And they did indeed most likely pursue this enrichment hedge, but in 2003, they had very little. And I'm gonna show you after a few photos, that's not the case today. So that's the visit in 2004. That was my first visit. They showed us the reactor and we were able to make a good assessment as to how much plutonium they had made, whether the reprocessing facility works, whether they had reprocessed the plutonium, and the answer was yes. And I concluded that nuclear weapons likely had been fabricated by January 2004. We went back in August 2005 on this photograph here. On the right is Vice Minister Kim Gae-gwan, and on the left is my colleague John Lewis. And this is right when the North Koreans were actually trying to get back to a dialogue. Dialogue existed during Clinton administration, ran out early in the Bush administration, and they're trying to reestablish it. And they wanted us to know we still want a light water reactor. That was part of the original deal of the agreed framework, is the Americans, South Koreans, and Japanese would build them a light water reactor. And then, of course, we walked away from that as they walked away. So he said, we still want that light water reactor. You're not going to get a deal otherwise. So in 2006, when the Americans again applied sanctions to North Korea, they went ahead and tested in October of 2006. Our team was back there a few weeks later. And on this photograph is the director, Lee Young-ho, of the North Korea Nuclear Center and myself. And in essence, the message then was, look, it worked and we're filled with pride. I said, well, it didn't work so well because it turns out it was less than 1 kiloton or so. But nevertheless, they said it worked. But I also knew by talking to him and others that they would have to test again because they didn't convince me. They, I'm sure, didn't convince Kim Jong-il, and they didn't convince their military. In 2007, this was actually, there was a period of about 18 months where there was good dialogue between the Bush administration and the North Koreans, and they had actually decided there would be initial actions to implement this 2005 joint statement, and I was allowed to go in to actually demonstrate that the North Koreans were making good faith steps in going in and disabling their nuclear facilities, not dismantling, but disabling. However, then let me skip to 2010, which is my most recent and last visit to North Korea. By the time the Obama administration came in, they decided to walk away, and indeed, they did the second nuclear test in 2009. And then in 2010, when they allowed me to come back in, they had this really big news. And the big news, in essence, was that they were taking this plutonium factory, in essence, the plutonium facility, and turning it into a facility for an experimental light water reactor and for enrichment. So they showed me a lot. Unfortunately, nobody's been back there since. I wasn't allowed to take photographs on that, and they didn't take any that they allowed me to keep. And so this is, in essence, what I saw. and that is a really ultra-modern centrifuge facility of about 2,000 centrifuges with significant capabilities. So they clearly wanted to show the United States, look, we not only have this plutonium path to the bomb, but while you guys are there not negotiating good faith, we also developed the second path to the bomb. And with combination of Google Earth and SketchUp 6, you can make models. And this is, in essence, the facility that they took me in to show me these centrifuges. So if we look now and go into 2014, so what's actually happened to the North Korean nuclear program? So they now have somewhere around 30 to 40 kilograms of plutonium. Highly enriched uranium, we're not quite sure. My Chinese colleagues that I work with very closely think that they've probably enriched up to about 100 kilograms, so maybe 3-4 bombs worth. Nuclear tests, they've now done 3 because they did another one in 2013. Nuclear weapons, sort of a handful of plutonium and likely a handful of highly enriched uranium. So they most likely have 10 bombs. So we go from 0 to 10 in 10 years. And as we look at long-range rockets, they actually now have had a successful long-range. They called it a space launch, but they've had a successful launch. So over 10 years in the diplomatic back and forth, first in the Bush administration, then in the Obama administration, what's happened is they've built up now an actually significant capability. And it's one that I really worry about because the track that they're on right now, without stopping them, it's quite easy to project that in 2 more years, they'll have twice as many bombs. And they'll, you know, most likely will do a fourth nuclear test because at this point, my assessment of those bombs is they can't miniaturize, they can't make them small enough to put on a missile. So they would still have crude delivery means. And if they really want to threaten the United States to have a deterrent, you'd like to be able to say that you can put it on a missile and you actually have a missile that doesn't blow up, you know, that you could launch. And so they've also shown their determination to have that threat by not only rolling out some new long-range missiles, at least in parade, but actually having road mobile missiles. And the road mobile ones are the ones that are best for deterrent because you can't find them easily. None of those have been yet tested successfully, but they have right now a very active missile program with engine tests and so forth. So again, if nothing is done in the next 2 years, the picture does not look very good.